in the movies. They're gonna make a big star out of me. We'll make a film about a man that's sad and lonely. And all I gotta do is act naturally.
Hello and welcome to Scripts Alive. This is a live table read podcast where I, Nathan P. Woodard,
and I, Andrew James Estes,
find unpublished, unproduced screenplays from the internet and bring them to life through the magic of podcasting. This is our very first episode. How are you feeling about our new and exciting podcast?
I'm very excited because reading is a skill that I possess, and that's what I'm just going to be doing aloud.
Lick the end of the pencil and then check that box. Can read.
It's a real feather in my cap.
I'm excited too, because for our very first episode, I feel like I got a real humdinger of a script here. I'll be honest, I chose it on title alone. I scanned to see how many different characters there were, but the title, I mean, it's just a title that grabs you.
Well, I'm completely in the dark. I have not read even the title.
Yeah. Well, I took the trouble of converting it to a PDF that just said ourscript.pdf. So I don't think it says at the very beginning what the title is. The title page is missing from this script, but I think it's going to be a good one. Also, we feel free to editorialize. You know, this is a table read. We're punching up. We're saying maybe cut this, combine these two characters, that kind of thing.
Okay.
This is the first read through, just to get a feel for things. There's going to be, listen, by the time that it gets to, you know, the editing booth, it's not even about He-Man anymore. It's called The Cyborg.
Is this script about a cyborg He-Man?
No, but did you know the movie Cyborg with the... is it Jean-Claude Van Damme or is it... yeah, it's Van Damme, right? That was the sequel to He-Man. That was He-Man 2.
No idea.
And they just threw out all the character names and replaced them with the names of guitars and said, good enough. They said, the kids don't want He-Man anymore. They want cyborgs.
They were right.
Shit. I would love to see the first draft of the Cyborg / He-Man 2 script. How did they translate what they had into that? I don't know, and I'll never know.
Did they have to make a whole new line of toys that were cyborg themed?
The Jean-Claude Van Damme cyborg action playset. I wonder. Well, you know, I was going to say, I wonder if any Van Damme movies ever had action figures, but I'm pretty sure that Street Fighter did. Probably the best thing to come out of the Street Fighter movie. That, and they did a whole photo spread in Wizard magazine where they had all the shots, but without the wires edited out, so you could just see Raul Julia as M. Bison floating up and saying a Bible verse or something. I believe he starts quoting the Book of Revelations as he floats up into the air at the end of that movie. Whew!
Did they have pictures of multiple people on wires and getting all tangled up? Did they have to untangle them?
Oh, man. They never show that. That's what I'd like. You know, Jackie Chan, he loves to include the bloopers because, you know, he's like an old style... you know, stuntman in the style of Buster Keaton or Burt Reynolds.
He's a fan of busting heads, but also of busting guts.
Yeah, he loves to add that blooper reel at the end. But I would love to see like a Chow Yun Fat like wire work movie with a blooper reel at the end where it's just him getting his wire, one where his pants fall down when he jumps into the air and Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. Maybe that's the next thing we do after this.
Wire work?
Once podcast. Ring, 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 ring. Hello. Got the big, big phone. You know, the one where you got the thing that you hold in one hand for your mouth and another on your ear. And you have to talk to the...
You got to give it a crank so you can talk to the operator.
Hello, Darla. Darla, can you connect me to Klondike 52222? It's Hollywood.
Yeah, they love us. Yeah.
They said it's a blank check. What do you want to do? Speaking of blank checks, you remember that movie Blank Check?
Oh, sure, I do.
Gets a blank check.
Mm-hmm.
That happened to me yesterday. I was at work and I found a blank check. Like someone had lost a blank check
that they had their signed. Checkbook.
No, no, there was no signature on it. But it had a routing number. It was like you could just steal this person's money. So I did what anyone responsible would do. I wrote $1 million in it.
Yes.
And then I made it out to my coworker while he was away at the bathroom and left it on his desk with the in the memo it said for lube. So if that guy's money gets stolen, $1 million of his money, just follow the lube. That'll send you to the criminal.
Do you think that you'll get to get your beak wet on that one?
Shit, my beak real slick.
Yeah.
Just real slippery. I hope so. Just a little lube on my beak.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, again, as I said before, I picked this script based on the title, but I can tell you that there are, I believe, I just like went through and read the character headings, and I believe that there are a total of 6 characters in this screenplay. It's only like 20 pages long.
Okay.
So we're not going to be here all night, but there is one main character named John.
Like a toilet?
No, J-O-N, like Jonathan. Okay,
good.
And then like a cavalcade of other characters he interacts with. Like it kept alternating John and then wife and then John and then somebody else.
Wife?
Wife is the name of a character.
She does not merit a name?
It's just listed as wife.
Just a mere plot contrivance, you know.
Mm-hmm.
She exists only to further the plot.
Maybe it's like Judge Reinhold, like her parents just named her wife. Fingers crossed on this one. We hope she turns out to be a wife. Prudence.
And Who are the rest of the gang?
Oh, there's just a whole bunch of just. I would say I would like to play all the other characters if that's all right with you.
Okay, so I will be John and wife.
John, no, I'll be wife. You be John because it's just like John goes here and. Then this person talks to him, and then John's over here, and this person. So it'd just be you as John.
Okay.
And then I'll handle all the secondary characters.
I find this acceptable.
Okay. Okay.
How are we going to handle stage direction?
I guess... I mean, I could read stage direction. Do you want to read stage direction?
It does not matter to me, but I just want to know.
Yeah, I didn't think about that. Yeah, you go ahead. You could be stage because I'm doing all this juggling. That'll be fine if you're just John and the stage direction.
Okay.
All right, folks. And I have not told AJ the title of this screenplay because I feel that it would maybe take away from what we're going into with fresh eyes and ears right now.
Okay.
Here we go.
Interior, office, day. A wall adorned with awards, newspaper articles, and a calendar establishing the year to be 2006. Older technical phone equipment, a blue box, old Motorola phone, etc. Encased in glass, we see John Klein packing some awards, framed photos, and desk toys into an archival box. Apart from the wall, the room is bare. A telephone on John's desk rings. He answers. Hello? A woman responds. It's his wife.
How's my little law enforcer doing?
John winces at his wife's lukewarm attempt at humor. Just tying up some loose ends before tomorrow. He pulls a hidden bottle out of his desk and buries it in the box. I think I'm going to need some more boxes. Anyway, what's up?
I was calling to see if you'd be home for dinner. There's a special offer at Le Chateau de Klein, exclusively for soon-to-be-retired policemen.
Ooh la la. He turns to look at the clock.
It's the special... I'm sorry. It's the special at Le Chateau de Klein, exclusive to soon-to-be-retired policemen. They were like, this is so specific, no one will ever be able to claim this special.
Well, I mean, it's good for Johnny Boy that, you know, he's packing in, you know, he's clearly a revered law enforcer. All of these awards that he's packing up.
Also, a bunch of old cell phones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like the idea of like a cop coming in with his retirement paperwork. Like, here I am, Le Chateau de Kevin. Give me that special. And they're like, oh, soon to be retired. I am sorry, monsieur. La policeman, you have failed our test. You have already been retired. He's like, hey. That's not fair. You know, most of us die on our very last day before retirement. It's poetic. Gone down in a hail of bullets.
Well, hopefully these snooty French waiters that are at his house are going to make it an exception for poor John.
All right.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Wait. She did say, I'm calling to see if you'd be home for dinner.
Yeah, his name is John Klein, so Le Chateau du Klein is just like she's probably making spaghetti.
Oh, do you think that's... Oh, it is John Klein. Oh, my God. Here I thought it was a real restaurant. It's just her being corny and calling their house their house of Klein.
You know, maybe he lives in a restaurant.
It's possible.
I don't know. I mean, this script could go anywhere.
My doctor, when I was a kid, the doctor's office was in his house. So maybe it's that sort of thing. A policeman lives in a restaurant, doctor lives in a house. It's crazy. It's like Richard Scarry's Busy Town. Fireman drives a banana car.
Yeah. That worm doesn't even have hands, but he can drive an apple car.
Yeah, he's driving around a little apple car.
He's using his one foot with a tennis shoe on it. Fine.
All right, jumping back in here.
Okay. He turns to look at the clock, 5:15. Tell the waiter I'll be there within the hour.
And the sommelier?
What would they recommend?
I've heard that the... it says 2013, but then it's crossed out and it says 2006, because I guess the person... This is literally a photocopy. It's not even like... It is a photocopy of a script. It says 2013 crossed out 2006 because that, I guess, is when this takes place. I've heard the 2006 Fruity Lexia is incomparable.
Sounds spectacular. So, black tie then?
Just get down here.
John tucks the box under his desk and looks at the rest of the things. He shrugs. I'm wrapping up now. I'll be there soon. Love you.
I know.
Click. John chuckles and shakes his head. He takes his jacket off of his chair and puts it on as he exits his office and walks down the hall. A woman holding coffee passes by. Later, Suze.
Night, John. One more, yeah?
John takes a deep breath and smiles. One more.
Be careful out there. If there's one thing I've learned from the Lethal Weapon movies, it's that bad stuff always happens right before retirement. On the other hand, there's also that whole dog biscuit thing, but whatever.
Are bad guys going to take my daughter, too?
You have a daughter?
No. Bye.
Time out. What's the dog biscuit thing?
I have no idea.
Sure.
Is that like the thing where the guys in the fraternity all jack off onto a dog biscuit and make you eat it to join?
Yeah, that's on your last day as a cop. Yeah. All the cops jack off on a dog biscuit and give it to you.
John continues down the hall and makes a turn, passing several desks. He exits the station.
Passing several desks.
Mm-hmm.
Want to make sure that that's in there.
Yeah, that scene is over.
But it's important that you show that this is a police station with more than one policeman, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
There were several desks in there.
He's not like your doctor. The precinct isn't in his house.
He's just walking down the hall from the police station to the restaurant.
Yeah. Yeah, it all takes place in one building, but that building wears many hats.
Yeah.
But a new scene begins. Exterior. Street. Day. Walking down a car-lined street, John fumbles for his keys. A phone booth down the street rings. John stops walking, then approaches the booth. He steps in and lifts the receiver. Hello?
Hello, John.
Who is this? How do you know who I am?
How I know what I know is irrelevant. What matters is I need you to listen to me very carefully. You have a certain set of skills that are of use to me.
Getting a little bit Liam Neeson-y there.
Now is not the time for jokes. Listen to me. You need to reactivate Polyus 2.
John is stunned. Polly, look, I don't know how you know that name or what kind of prank this is, but I'm not having a part of it. Go mess with someone else. John hangs up and walks away. A building down the street explodes. John whips around to see debris flying from the building's windows and several people running away in terror. Car alarms sound. The phone booth rings again. John races back and answers again.
This is no prank!
Who are you?
I am Adolf Hitler!
Title screen. Hitler phone booth.
Hitler phone booth.
Hitler phone booth. So is 2006 the year the classic Colin Farrell film Phone Booth came out?
You know, I'm not sure. I'd forgotten about the movie Phone Booth. Hang on, I'm looking it up. Let's take a look. Phone Booth came out in 2002, so this person was maybe pitching this as a potential sequel.
Yeah, or at least like a spin-off. Possibly.
Yeah. Spin-off. It's in the same cinematic universe as Phone Booth.
Okay.
They have Hitler Phone Booth and Caveman Phone Booth.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Maybe. Okay.
No, sorry. I want to hear what you said. Maybe.
I was thinking maybe there could be a phone booth with the first phone. The Alexander Graham Bell is,
Alexander
picks
Graham
it up
Bell.
And like, Mr. Watson, I need you. And instead of, Mr. Watson is the bad guy. It says, not so fast.
It's Alexander Graham Bell in the future. He's talking to his future self. And he's like, listen, I must warn you. You're about to spill acid on your lap. And he's like, it's too late. I've already done it. Okay.
Okay. Continuing. Exterior. Phone booth. Day. John is on the phone, looking rather confused. You're Adolf Hitler?
Yes.
Title card. Piece of paper draped over the name of the author of the script.
Whoever uploaded this to the internet was kind enough to tear off a little piece of notebook paper and cover up the name of whoever wrote this so that they wouldn't be harassed.
Okay. 4. Exterior. Phone booth. Day. John is now very confused. Hitler? That just doesn't make any...
Do you want me to prove I'm serious again?
No. That's not necessary. What do you want? Hitler.
Like I said before, you're going to reactivate Polyus 2.
I don't know if...
I know you, John. I know your past. You will make it happen. You have 2 hours. Don't be late.
Click. John stands in stunned silence for a second, then sprints back to the station. Interior, police station, night. John frantically stumbles into the station, scanning the room. Where's Bill? Suze pokes her head up from her cubicle.
Back already?
Shut the fuck up, Suze. Now's not the time. Suze is taken aback, mouth agape. Her head lowers back down. Bill steps into the room from an office.
Jonathan.
Captain, there's something very urgent I need to talk to you about.
This is the captain. He called him Jonathan.
Not just me, John.
An agent in a sharp suit steps out into the room, gesturing to John to step into Bill's office. Interior, office, night. The three men step inside. There are 2 other agents standing in the back of the room. The other agent extends his hand.
Agent Roger Johnson, ACES, Telesecurity Division.
John shakes Agent Johnson's hand, still a bit jarred by the situation that has developed.
Agent Johnson and his accomplices here arrived about 5 minutes ago in an unmarked helicopter. He said you would know what this is about.
I think I do, sir, but it's almost too ridiculous to believe.
Not as ridiculous as you might think, Mr. Klein. We're gonna need you to come with us.
Exterior, street, night. John, Bill, and the 3 agents exit the police station as an unmarked helicopter lands in the street. Helicopters fly overhead as roadblocks are formed, sealing off the police station and phone booth. The helicopter door opens, and Agent Johnson steps to the side.
Please, after you, watch your head.
The 2 pile into the helicopter, with Agent Johnson afterward. The other 2 agents stand idly as the helicopter flies away, then leave in opposite directions. Interior, helicopter, night. The 3 men sit in the helicopter. The windows are blacked out.
You must be pretty stunned right now.
You're a mind reader.
Look, this might be a bit much to swallow, but once I get you up to speed, it should make more sense.
I'll have to take your word on that for the time being. Not to sound out of line or anything, but why are you with us, Bill? Bill turns to John.
Did I ever tell you what I did in the 80s, John?
No, sir. You said it was confidential.
The captain of the police is just walking around like, hey, fellas, you know what I did in the 80s? Can't tell you. It was confidential. I'd love to tell you, but I'd have to kill you.
Care to field this one, Agent Johnson?
Mr. Murphy is an esteemed ACES veteran. He worked in telesecurity for 20 years.
You were a spook? What made you stop?
Y2K. After everything went to crap, I couldn't take it anymore. Don't get me wrong, when you're young and invincible, it's a great job. But when you get married and have kids, not being able to tell them a single thing about my life damn near killed me. And when the millennium came around and everybody was scared, I just couldn't bear being away from them all the time. I was losing them, you know?
Wait. It sounds like his job was something, his telesecurity, like making sure people aren't fucking around with the phone lines.
Yeah.
Oh, the fact that it was just too much. Once I had a wife and kids, I was too much on the line.
Yeah. He couldn't spend, you know, his whole life chasing the jerky boys around. It's a young man's game.
All right.
And I thought my retirement was well earned. The helicopter lands and the three men get out. Interior, bunker, night. The three men walk through a dark hallway lined with guards.
Mr. Murphy stayed on as a sleeper in the event of a national disaster. When we detected activity in the phone booth outside your station, we knew something big was coming.
Wait, so you know about Hitler? The men reach the end of the hallway, and Agent Johnson scans his palm print to open a sliding door.
More than you could possibly believe.
The door opens to reveal a large room with dozens of personnel, multiple screens, and a large screen with a map of the world with several lines connecting continents. Mother of God.
This is our main control room, dedicated to tracking the activity of Hitler through phone networks.
Through phone networks?
Through phone networks. Oh, of course. Sorry. Allow me to explain.
The men walk over to a small desk with several monitors.
The thing to realize is that Adolf Hitler, as you know him, is not alive.
Well, he'd be what? 120 years old or something?
116. He might not be alive as a person, but he is alive as a force.
John doesn't quite understand. What? Agent Johnson presses a few keys at the desk and brings up some dated file photos.
In 1895, the British government developed a system for preserving the essence of significant individuals in the event of national catastrophe. The person's spirit, if you will, would be captured and sent as electronic impulses through copper wires to a separate location to facilitate such a system and to also rationalize the cost to taxpayers, not to mention prevent questions from arising. A year later, the system was modified to send audio instead and patented by its chief designer, Alexander Graham Bell.
So you're telling me that the telephone system was invented as some kind of soul machine? That seems like a bit of a stretch.
Well, you could call it a soul train if you wanted.
Agent Johnson pulls up another series of images.
We believe that Adolf Hitler first gained knowledge of the system at the Berlin Olympics in 1936 through British diplomats interested in the concept of preserving his soul to achieve theoretically eternal life. He started to formulate a scheme to steal the British system plans just as World War II began to break out.
Surely you can see how ridiculous this sounds.
In 1940, Operation Sea Lion was devised, an aborted plan for Nazis to invade Great Britain. Or at least, that's what we thought. We later discovered that Operation Sea Lion was a cover operation to divert attention from the real goal, capturing the plans at the height of the Blitz.
Agent Johnson pulls up more photos, this time of several documents. Some are heavily censored.
Through interrogation completed before the Nuremberg trials, we discovered that Hitler did not, in fact, shoot himself in the Führer bunker, rather activating a crude facsimile of the British system to leave his physical state in light of advancing Soviet troops.
Didn't they find his body, though?
A dead body, yes, but the body doesn't disappear, merely the soul.
Souls don't have dental records.
So what you're trying to tell me is Adolf Hitler is still alive in a non-corporeal state inside the telephone network, and he's been laying dormant since 1945 until now for some reason, which is not quite clear.
Almost. Look over here.
The men walk to the large screen with the map of the world on it.
This map charts telephone connections worldwide, landlines, cellular, undersea cables, everything. If a spiritual presence is detected in the network, we see it right here. We've got eyes all over the world.
Since 1945, we've detected 10 abnormalities, of which we believe Adolf Hitler to be of some involvement with.
You've got to be shitting me.
Son, this goes far deeper than you could possibly imagine. Korea, Vietnam, Kuwait.
Y2K?
Y2K.
Now, I am a retirement-aged police officer that they're calling son. Like, really, all of these, like, this is a...
Yeah, no, my Bill is 130 years old, too.
Okay. John sits down. But why me? He knew my name. What I did.
Now, I just... The John sits down thing. They're saying, yeah, he did Korea, Vietnam, Kuwait. And then he goes, Y2K.
Yeah.
This takes place in 2006. Y2K is come and gone with a whimper.
This is an alternate universe where Hitler lives in the phone network.
His hands shaking as he takes his glasses off of his face. My God. But why me?
But why me? He knew my name. What I did.
You've pretty much answered your own question. What you did.
When you worked as a telecom specialist in late 80s, did you or did you not work on the Polyus project?
I did.
And what did you create for those satellites?
Connectivity circuits.
And the first satellite failed, did it not?
It did.
But there was a second satellite, wasn't there?
There was.
Do you know what that satellite was for?
I was always told it was identical to the first.
The first was a deliberate failure to make the second look like a retry. It wasn't.
You know, like we said it before we started, these two characters could be one character. There is no reason why he had to go back to his work and be like, hey, Captain. And then the Captain's like, hey, meet this other guy. And then the other guy and him just trade off lines for the rest of the fucking movie. You could just have one guy come up to him and say, I'm Agent Johnson. Anyways.
The first was a deliberate failure to make the second look like a retry. It wasn't.
The USA and Soviet Union joined together to make an orbital weapon, John Polyus II.
But why would they join forces?
Everybody knew they wouldn't be around forever. The Soviets were hemorrhaging money, and the U.S., well, you know how they are with weapons.
John gets up and paces around.
What do they mean? You know how they are with weapons?
We like them.
Always sharing them with the Soviets. We just get too excited. We can't help ourselves. We want them to know we got a new weapon.
It's not enough to have the weapon and to use the weapon. Weapons must be shared with others.
You got to show it off, yeah. Concealed carry? No, 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 no.
Yeah, you know, put walk that in your hand. See how that feels, you know?
You got a good weight to it. On your hip. You got to spin it around from time to time. Take it apart and clean it.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, sir, this is an Arby's.
Go outside, have a catch.
You know, I actually did see like a guy in a cowboy getup with a big six shooter at Arby's one time.
Was he, you know, I don't know. Like they have that big hat logo. I'm wondering if he just like not so good at reading, but just said like, this must be the place for me.
Well, they got a big old cowboy hat on the side. I reckon this is the place.
Hot damn, I've never seen a hat so big.
Now point me toward the horse. I'm going to get me a Ken-Ken girl.
John gets up and paces around. Wait, wait, wait. I'm missing something here. So Hitler's in the phone network. Yeah, yeah. Orbital weapons. I helped make. Sure. But still... why call me?
Did he want you to reactivate it?
He did. Bill raises his eyebrows. But then what?
He can move from phone to phone, continent to continent, at will, even to satellites. What he can't do is move to a deactivated satellite.
So he wants me to turn it on so he can...
precisely.
But where would he fire? It's not like the war is still going.
Think about it, John. What, of all things, is a complete monument to everything Hitler despises? Born out of the war itself.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
The light bulb in John's head goes off. Israel.
Israel.
So Hitler wants to destroy Israel? Why now, of all times?
Have you looked outside recently since Y2K? Society's gone to the dogs. Hyperinflation, crime, disease.
It's Weimar Germany.
Exactly.
The public needs a strong leader, and in a time of need, anything goes.
Dear God. Agent Johnson takes two things out of his jacket and places them in John's hands.
You're our one hope. That satellite needs to warm up for 1 minute after activation, and Hitler can't be in more than one place at a time. If you seal him in the satellite and destroy it, he'll be gone forever. This phone card, when used...
there's a phrase I haven't heard in a long time.
I hope they remembered to load it with minutes before.
Don't forget, here's a nickel to scratch the little silver thing off the back of it. This phone card, when used, will completely overload local phone circuits and whatever you connect it to. Use it wisely. This is a mobile phone with a direct secure link to us. He can't get into this. Once you've activated the satellite, let us know and we'll try to help in any way we can.
Bill looks at his watch.
John, how much time did he give you?
2 hours.
We need to move.
John shakes hands with Agent Johnson.
Godspeed. Also, make him Agent Stevenson or something. It isn't another John. God damn. Too many similar names.
Yeah, they could have gone the wife route.
Yeah, just Agent. Captain. Führer.
Yeah.
Secretary. Boy, that really says something, huh? That the secretary got a name, but then the wife didn't.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think that the script is going to pass the Bechdel test.
I don't think it's going to pass the sniff test for the screenwriter's wife.
Yeah. Exterior, street, night. John and Bill both run to the ringing phone booth. John lifts the receiver. I'm here.
You're late.
I'm sorry.
I told you not to be late. Do you think this is a game?
Look, I tried to make it back in time.
I'm sure that you'll make a fine line in your eulogy speech.
John freezes. Bill begins to sweat. What are you talking about? The sounds of a police scanner come through the phone handset.
We have a deceased female at 138 Lexington Avenue. Signs of electrocution. Appears to have been using her phone. Looks like might have been a power spike. Looks like she's married, too. There's a ring on the finger and a fully set dinner table.
The scanner noise turns off.
You tried to make it back in time.
John is sobbing. You son of a bitch! You son of a bitch!
You have all the time in the world for crying later on. Activate the satellite.
Give me 2 minutes. John starts pressing buttons in the phone booth, connecting trunks and intercontinental links. Eventually, a dial tone begins. Exterior, low Earth orbit, night. Polyus 2 powers on and starts moving. Exterior, street, night. John gets on the mobile phone and calls Agent Johnson.
I'm here.
It's turning on. Listen, now it's on. You can reposition it before Hitler connects, yeah?
I am now being told that we have position control of the satellite.
Right. I need you to move it as far away as... The phone battery has died. Bill is sweating. No, not now, Captain. Do you know any way we can... Captain? Bill is clutching at his chest and falls to the ground. John runs to his assistance and starts crying again. Oh, God, Captain, not you too. Bill struggles a few words out between deep breaths and winces.
Bill, it's Bill.
Bill, not like this. Not like...
Stop your fucking crying right now and forget about me. I should have died in Y2K, for Christ's sake. Jonathan, look, he killed your wife. He killed 6 million people. And he's about to kill millions more. You go get that son of a bitch.
John nods through tears.
Oh, and John.
Yes, sir.
Happy retirement.
Wait, so did Hitler kill him, or did he just have a heart attack because he's so old?
Maybe a little of column A and a little of column B.
It does not seem like anything out of the ordinary happened to Bill. He was just sitting there with his hands in his pockets waiting for John to finish a phone call to Hitler.
Maybe if, he was going to die so soon, we could have just put his soul in the phone network and he could have fought Hitler himself.
There's a phone booth right there. Could have just loaded him up.
But, you know, that's not how this hey, goes.
Listen, I'm no telesecurity expert.
Yeah. I don't know the ins and outs of how all this works. Bill smiles and then grows lifeless. I'm guessing he's enjoying his little last joke of just wishing me a happy retirement.
I'm like picturing that death scene where he's like just stiffening up and doing the Grinch smile at the same time.
Ooh. John lets go of him and begins to stand, sadness turning into anger. He walks back to the phone booth and puts the receiver to his ear. It's activated. Hitler disconnects as he moves to the satellite. John looks around for a junction box and finds one, past the roadblock. He runs like he's never run before.
Wait, so I'd like to point out that this movie went to the trouble of explaining how he goes to the left down a hallway past several desks.
Mm-hmm.
But they do not at all even bother to explain how we're going to show that Hitler is traveling from a phone to a satellite.
Mm-hmm. I'd also like to point out that some people are just quick grievers. I mean, John processes his emotions very well, very efficiently.
He's processing everything very efficiently. Mm-hmm. It's probably why they had him working on the Polyus 2 satellite.
Yeah. And he's like probably glad that he never had to learn his wife's name, because, I mean, she's gone.
It's funny that nobody explained to him when he came on as the lead of the Polyus 2 project that it was all just a ruse to capture Hitler. They were like, listen, don't worry about what we did with that first one. Just do the same thing without any of the prior knowledge. Do it exactly the same. It's a trap for Hitler. No, it's not. What am I saying? Of course not. That's ridiculous. Forget about that. Also, don't pay attention to this guy over here. He's going to be your boss at the police station later on when you both move from telecom to police officer.
it's a natural move. A lot of people make that switch.
Yeah.
Their skill sets are very similar. Exterior. Low Earth orbit. Night. The satellite is repositioning. Exterior. Street. Night. John sprints past a bunch of civilians and rips open the junction box. Interior. Bunker. Night. A concerned Agent Johnson watches the bank of monitors. Exterior. Street. Night. John rips out wires with his bare hands and bridges a connection, then races back to the phone booth. Exterior. Street. Day. What the fuck? Hours have passed.
Oh no, this is on the other side of the world.
Okay, that's fine. A kid in a Jerusalem market looks up at the gleaming object in the sky.
Don't look at the sun, kid.
Exterior, low Earth orbit, night. The satellite has finished repositioning and is glowing as it charges. Exterior, street, night.
God damn it.
John runs into the phone booth, lifts the receiver, and punches a series of digits.
I'm so jealous. Go ahead.
A dial tone, then satellite connection tone is heard. He rips the phone card out of his pocket. Your call could not see connected.
God damn it! Oh, I'm so jealous!
He jams the card into the slot, slams the receiver down, and runs away from the phone booth. The phone booth starts glowing and sparking. Is this Bill the time Ted. Machine from Bill and Ted?
Bill and Ted are about to show up.
I hope it's Rufus.
Yeah.
Exterior. Street. Night. Street lights go out. Phone towers start shooting massive electric bolts. The phone booth explodes and sends a massive electrical charge to the junction box. Exterior. Desert. Night. Satellite dishes send massive amounts of energy up to the satellite. Exterior. Low Earth orbit. Night.
Nine!
The satellite explodes! Exterior. Street. Night. The shockwave from the explosion shatters windows and sets off car alarms. John, on the ground, rolls onto his back, sees the aftermath, and can only laugh.
He's like, what a wacky day. Whew. Oh, I better get to bed. I got work in the morning.
Wife isn't going to... Oh, wait, she's dead.
Oh, she is not going to believe this.
Yeah. Exterior, street, night. John, covered in a blanket, is airlifted away from the street as ACES forces come in to clean up. Title card. 1 week later. Interior. Bathroom. Day. John has been sitting shiva for his wife and Bill. He is shaving in the bathroom mirror with Agent Johnson standing in the doorway. Both are formally dressed.
You know, I thought the beard kind of suited you.
Well, it's a bit late now, isn't it? John cleans up and the two walk out to the living room, which is completely bare. John removes the ribbon around his arm and peeks through the window. Two agents in a car are waiting.
Ready to go?
John grabs a box of things. Yeah. They walk outside, where we see a for sale sign on the house. Everybody gets in the car and drives off. Exterior. Cemetery. Day. The car pulls up to a cemetery where John and Agent Johnson get out. They walk to his wife's headstone. John leaves his mobile phone. You know, she always said my obsession with my phone would be the death of me. Agent Johnson manages an awkward smile. They both walk to a car. Like,
you know, your wife has just died from phone-related Hitler.
Don't leave me, Agent Johnson. You're the only friend I have left.
You got to get a little less weird about doing jokes about your dead wife.
They both walk to a car waiting for John, where he places his box of things and walks to the driver's side door. Agent Johnson stops him.
You're going to be okay?
I'll be just fine.
Well, take this just in case.
Agent Johnson hands John a small bunch of coins.
A small bunch. Like a little pouch with a dollar sign on it.
Yeah. Maybe it's a roll of coins?
I would imagine a roll of coins makes more sense, right?
Mm-hmm. I've never called it a bunch.
Keep it in your fist and punch somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's a typo. It's supposed to say punch of coins.
What's this for?
Might need to make a phone call.
Both of them smile. John gets in his car and pulls away. The end.
It's in the way that you use it.
Oh, I want. Can Brass and Pocket play over the
Brass and Pocket? Yeah. Mm. Fantastic! Oh my god! What did you think?
I enjoyed it. It is pretty rough, and I think that there needs to be a lot more world building to be done. But I think that the one liner. I feel like it exists primarily to
your call. Could Nazi
be connected? Yes.
Yeah.
Though having that one in there precludes having the line, I did not see that coming.
Yeah.
Which they very much could have used. Whew,
dodge that bullet. Yeah. No, I think that just based on the premise and that one-liner, you could probably make a trailer for this that would get $80 million worth of people into the seats to see that in the theater. They'd be like, oh, shit, did you see this Hitler phone booth trailer?
I'd like to suggest...
so bad it's good.
I'd like Agent Johnson to be played by Tommy Lee Jones.
Oh, yeah. Let's talk Dreamcast for a moment here. John, what are we thinking?
Let's see. There, you have three main characters, and John gets called son, despite the fact that I'd imagine he's at
close
the
to
youngest.
Retirement.
He's got to be in his 50s at least.
Yeah.
But he's the youngest of the three.
I would say, here's all right. What do you think about this? Martin Freeman.
I had that in mind as well. actually going to say
Freeman.
That.
Yeah. He's got gray hair, but he's got kind of a boyish face.
Mm-hmm.
But he's got to be like in his 50s now. And he could do like an okay American accent so we can get him on the cheap. Mm-hmm. We're not paying Christian Bale prices here.
Okay, who do you think is going to play Suze, his secretary?
Ooh. I would say that's a young role, don't you think? Or should it be an older person?
I don't know. I think maybe this is one of those movies that they make, Hollywood likes to make, just so that all the old people can be in a movie and keep their Screen Actors Guild cards.
Because here's what I was thinking, is that this would be a role that they would give to someone who is seen as a comic actor.
You know? Yeah.
Like when they do that in like Jurassic Park, where they like some of the secondary character actors are like comedians and they're not there to get the butts in the seats. They're there. So once you're there, you're like, oh, I recognize that person. But then the director and the producers are like, but we didn't have to pay them because you recognize them. Here's Hank Azaria in Godzilla.
Like, I don't know.
Oh, like, yeah, that guy was from Mad About You.
I'd say we go all out and spend money like there's no tomorrow. Like Hitler might destroy the world with a satellite weapon.
Mm-hmm.
And just bring out the big guns.
Okay.
Oprah.
Oh, shit. All right. It's been a minute. You know, she was a little humbled by the commercial and critical success of her adaptation of the
movie that nobody watched and I forgot the title of.
I wanted to say The Wind in the Willows, but that's a different thing.
It's not The Wind in the Willows.
Yeah, what is that?
What if Oprah had made The Wind in the Oprah as Mr. Toad?
what if it was Oprah and Gail and a Frog and Toad Are Friends adaptation?
They'd have like the critic quotes, the splash quotes on the poster, and it would say, a wild ride. Thrill a minute.
All right, Oprah. But if we can't get Oprah, second choice, Alana Glazer.
Okay, yeah.
That's bargain basement prices.
Yeah, maybe we should be doing a spend all the money versus spend some money, but make money.
Okay.
Okay. Well, we really only have like two more characters. Yeah, so.
We got Bill, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who do you like for Bill? I mean, it's got to be older.
Well, I think it just might be because the name's Bill, but I was picturing Stephen Root.
Oh, I like that. Yeah, Stephen Root.
But that's not spending all the money casting.
But I like that. It's unexpected. It's is Gene Hackman still alive?
I believe he is. I think he's just retired, but if, you know, if there were any film that could get him to come out of retirement.
Hitler Phone Booth could be the one. Let's say we will offer it to Hackman, but at the same time, we will
we're going to have like a Clint Eastwood contingency plan.
Well, we'll use Hackman, the fact that we offered it to Hackman, as leverage to try and get what's his name? The other actor we just said.
Clint Eastwood?
Was it Clint Eastwood is what you said?
No. Steven Root,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Clint Eastwood. If Clint Eastwood wants to do it, it's his. He can play Hitler for all I care. Just get him in our movie. And then, of course, Hitler.
Yeah, Hitler. There have been a fair amount of people who have already played Hitler. I don't know if anybody would want to reprise that role or not.
Yeah, Taika Waititi, most famously.
Mm-hmm.
Probably best cinematic turn as Hitler. What about this? Everybody loved Tom Cruise in Tropic Thunder. What if we did like a funny stunt casting? We get Steven Spielberg to play Hitler in our movie.
You think he would? Yeah, all right.
Or like, Steven, look at this. We're a couple of young upstarts like you making your first movie.
Will you be our Jaws?
Will you be our, we just need a little help getting over that first hurdle. We got to make our Hitler Phone Booth movie. And we want you to be our Hitler. Listen, do you want us to give it to someone who might actually be Hitler in disguise? We know for a fact Steven Spielberg is not Hitler in disguise.
Yeah.
Hiding out.
Well, we don't want to give it to like a method actor. Like if Daniel Day-Lewis,
we give it
like
to he Daniel would
become
Day-Lewis,
Hitler, and then we have another
get
Hitler
into the phone, and then he would shoot a satellite at Israel.
Yeah, we need to.
Next thing you know,
somebody.
Jerusalem just wiped off the map because Daniel Day-Lewis got too into the character.
It's a real danger. So we have to pick somebody that we know will.
We're throwing out this script and we're rewriting it. It's a page one rewrite. Now it's about Daniel Day-Lewis getting too into character as Hitler.
But also an actor who'd have to be coaxed out of retirement.
Yeah. Like, okay, one more job.
Yeah.
All right. This time. I'm Hitler. You know who I think out of all of the actors who are like so up their own ass that they don't break character ever for like months and months? The one that I could see actually becoming Hitler is Jim Carrey.
Yeah. I knew you were going to say
one
that.
One hundo. Above everyone else who is like, oh yeah, that guy tried to rape me because he played a rapist. He said it was because of the character. Out of all of those schmucks, Jim Carrey all the way.
I think that if we did a page one rewrite of this, Jim Carrey would be interested, but
yeah,
I don't know if we can do that to humanity.
Here's the premise, Jim. You are such a great method actor that you actually become Hitler. He'll either love it or he'll do a very tacky painting insulting us.
I'm down for either outcome. Yep. Let's do it.
Also, if he loves us, he will also do a very tacky and insulting painting of us.
I'll hang it in my bathroom.
All right. Any final thoughts about Phone Booth Hitler? Or is it Hitler Phone Booth? I've already closed the
window. My thumb is way up.
I took a risk and I feel like it paid off. I didn't know if it was going to be any good. I literally just saw that it said Hitler phone booth. And I said, okay, I'm in. Yeah. So there you go, folks. Hitler phone booth. And if you know who wrote Hitler phone booth, please put them in touch with us. We would love to give them some royalties for however much money we make off of reading this.
And also just like toss some ideas around.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, maybe we do like Stalin on the internet. I feel like that one could be a big seller on what's Ben Shapiro's new streaming service?
Oh, I have no idea.
Well, that's one more thing they can put on there, yeah, along with whatever the lady who used to be on The Mandalorian is doing for them now. Anyways, folks, this has been Scripts Alive. Thank you for listening. Go give us a rating on iTunes and tell Hitler to shove it.
Yeah.